Welcome, everybody.
Welcome. Good afternoon and welcome to this webinar. I am Magali Larenaudy. I am a scientific officer for the Laboratory of Plant Health of ANSES, which is the French Agency for Food, Environmental and Occupational Health and Safety. I'm part of the Expert Appraisal and Biological Risk Unit. I will present this webinar with Caterina Campese.
So, good afternoon. I am Caterina Campese and I am a trainee in the plant health team of the Alpha Unit of EFSA, the European Food Safety Authority. You don't know that yet, but with us today there is also Maria Rosaria Mannino, our supervisor and coordinator. She's here, but she is behind the doors and she is ready to answer all of your written questions.
So you can take advantage of this webinar either by following us during the next hour or afterwards, since the webinar will be available online on the YouTube EFSA channel. We are using Adobe Connect as a platform to broadcast the webinar. The webinar will be conducted in English. There is a question and answer section on the right of your screen, and you can send us questions during the webinar. Please send the question in English. If you have any technical issue, let us know by writing a message in the technical issues support chat at the bottom of the screen. Finally, you will see the presentation with a live tool on your screen. At the end of the webinar, we will have a question and answer session, and we will try to directly answer to some of your questions.
So let's start. What is horizon scanning?
EFSA performs horizon scanning activities in order to retrieve information on new, emerging or recurring pests that may be of concern for the European Union territory.
Okay, here you can see our project framework. In the framework of the new European Plant Health Regime, DG SANTE, so the Directorate General for Health and Food Safety of the European Commission, requested EFSA in 2016 to carry out a horizon scanning exercise of plant health threats to the European Union territory, in order to support risk managers to address these new potential risks. Now, my colleague Magali will try to explain you how this whole project works.
So, following this request, EFSA started the horizon scanning project. The steps are indicated on the slide. We monitor media and scientific literature to find articles on new or emerging pests. Relevant news from media and articles from scientific literature are gathered in monthly newsletters. Media and scientific newsletters are monthly delivered to the European Commission, published on the EU collaborative platform Circa BC, and presented at the monthly meeting of the Section on Plant Health of the Plant, Animal, Food and Food Committee of European Commission for consideration by the risk managers. On the not yet regulated pest in the European Union, EFSA also carries out a scoring exercise that allows to highlight relevant pests for the European Union. The presentation of the results of the horizon scanning activity may support risk managers in taking action, such as ask EFSA to carry out pest categorization or decide to enhance the surveillance of the territories and their borders.
In this slide, you can actually see our collaboration. Of course, for this project, EFSA benefits from many collaboration. First of all, we should mention the Directorate General Joint Research of the European Commission, the GRC. The GRC built the Medicis platform and they adapted it to the plant health monitoring. Actually, at our request, they are now implementing the scientific source methodology. Then we have the EFSAR working group. With our working group, we meet monthly. Our working group is composed by three experts that help us to review the draft newsletter, both the media newsletter and the scientific newsletter. They also help us with the monitoring methodology and with the pest scoring methodology. The PES scoring methodology has been carried out by HEFSA and ANSES, the French Agency for Food, Environmental and Occupational Health and Safety. But with ANSES, in the context of a task grant, we mainly work on the scientific literature monitoring. Furthermore, we also have internal collaboration, like the ongoing collaboration with the Assessment and Methodological Support Unit, AMU, and the collaboration with the Scientific Committee at Emerging Risk, SHARE.
So, for our project, we use MEDICIS IT platform. MEDICIS stands for Medical Information System, and it has been developed by the Directorate General Joint Research Center, GRC, of the European Commission to promptly identify potential human health threats using available information. The tool has been adapted for plant health purposes.
Yes, thanks to this tool, we can carry out the main EFSA output, which are the monitoring, media and scientific monitoring, which then translate into two newsletters, the media and the scientific newsletters. These newsletters are monthly brought to the attention of the European Commission and to the NPPO, the National Plant Protection Organizations. Okay. Here we present you MEDICIS, which is our platform, the platform thanks to which we perform our monitoring. MEDICIS is a publicly available platform. It means that it's freely accessible. The GRC adapted it to the plant health monitoring, and thanks to it, we can retrieve from the web media, news and scientific literature. Furthermore, MEDICIS is able to retrieve only the most updated version of the web page. It means that we can basically set individual, according to every website, the frequency of the updating of the article that we retrieve, even if this frequency normally ranges from minutes to days. MEDICIS is able to cluster news, to collect events, organization, location, all in order to detect new emerging risk. In this moment, this very powerful tool is being redesigned. So we decided to provide you with the current link that you can see on your left. But also with the provisionally available future website that you can see on your right. On your right, you can also see a menu in the screenshot with the orange borders. In this menu, you can basically find the EFSA section with all the matters related to plant health. So, if you click on EFSA and then you click on plant health, you will see something like this. This is a screenshot from the current website, but of course this page will be available also in future on the future website. From this page, you can actually see all of our ontology, so the wall of our ontology and all our keywords. So you can really explore everything we do to research the web. In this moment, ontology and keywords may seem concepts a little bit abstract, but just in the next slide, my colleague Magali will explain you everything.
The newest tool of MEDICIS is an interactive web-based application. It is available under subscription via a simple internet browser. NewDesk allows us to produce and edit newsletters. On the workspace of NewDesk, so on the right part of the slide, it is possible to visualize the automatic selection of articles made by the platform, gather selected articles in ad hoc templates, and edit the draft newsletters. The category editor of NewDesk, so on the left side on the slide, is used to customize and organize the keyword we are using. Keywords can be the common and scientific name of the pest, specific term related to the disease or the symptoms provoked by this pest. For a given pest, the set of keywords forms an ontology. Also, we intend to monitor new pests, so pests we don't know yet. We don't have the name yet. We have created a set of generic keywords relevant to plant pests as a whole, but not specific to any given known pest. Some non-specific keywords are emerging, invasion, spread, etc., but also the crop's name and terms related to damages, like damaging, chlorotic, infection, etc.
Okay, this slide is the category editor of the new Desk IT tool. In here you can see keywords, you can see categories, and you can see filters. As my colleague Magali was saying before, categories often correspond to scientific pest name, but they can also correspond to the disease name when the scientific name of the causal agent is not known yet. This category is composed by many keywords. We not only have positive keywords, as Magali said, but we only have negative keywords. So to show you what is a negative keyword, a very practical example can be that in this time of pandemic, we were looking into the web, researching for plant health viruses, plant viruses. But of course, in our research, there was a lot of noise concerning coronavirus, COVID, and so on. So in order to clean our system from this noise, we had to introduce negative keywords like coronavirus, COVID, and all the related synonyms in order to clean the noise, but still being able to perform our research on the web, gathering all the articles into which we were interested concerning plant health viruses. Another thing that you can see in the slide are the filters. The filters are an important function of Medesis because they allow the user to structure categories together. What does it mean? Basically, we can have filters that group categories together, for example, specific taxonomic group all together. And you know the categories correspond already to scientific pairs. So we will basically have filters in which we already know more or less which are the topics that a specific filter is grouping and gathering. As you can see here, the filters are useful also when we work on the workspace, and probably mainly when we work in the workspace. The workspace is another section of the new Desk IT tool. As you can see, when we have access to the workspace, we open the filters, so again, all the related articles to a category, so to some specific pest, and we can see all the articles that Medesis found through its automatized research. We can go through all these articles that appear with their metadata, their link, all the information that we need. We can open them, we can read them, and we can perform a better manual selection. So when we decide that an article is relevant, we pick it up and we drop it into the box that you see on your left. This box already corresponds to our newsletter template. Indeed, when at the end of the month we decide that the selection is completed, at the end of the month, because we try to produce monthly newsletter, we download all the articles already saved into the template through the function publish that I hope you can see on this slide. When we download the document, we can already decide its format, thanks to Medesis. That can be a Word document, an XML, or a PDF.
As Katerina said, when the article selection is done, so at the end of the ongoing month, the workspace allows us to edit a Word file which contains all the articles we have chosen to select. After reviewing, two drafts are produced, a newsletter containing media articles and a scientific article newsletter. These two drafts are sent to the experts of the working group for their suggestions before our monthly meeting, during which we discuss the relevancy of the articles selected with Medesis. And of course, the article suggested by the experts. Here is the way we proceed. The article selection is made from the first to the last day of the ongoing month. It is the first orange arrow. Few days before the end of the month, the newsletters are drafted. They are then sent to the working group experts, and their relevancy is discussed during our monthly meeting. When we all agree on the newsletter's content, it can be finalized and sent to the European Commission after the validation of EFSA. It is then presented and discussed during the plant health section meeting of the Plant Animal Food and Feed Commission of the European Commission. Let's not forget that during this time, the following months have started, and the article published need to be monitored. It is symbolized by the second orange arrow.
Okay, to finalize our manual selection of articles, we follow criteria. These allow us to focus the selection on information regarding finding outbreaks, spread of potentially dangerous pests that are not yet regulated in European regulations. But however, we also select articles on quarantine pests that are already regulated in European Union. For the latter, newsletter covers also topics such as control method or detection, identification method, and the impact of mandatory measures. Here I will provide you with some example trying to highlight the use of our criteria. Starting with the example one, we take this example from newsletter number 36, and it is about Xylella fastidiosa. As you probably already know, Xylella fastidiosa is a worldwide known dangerous bacteria. It is a quarantine pest in the European Union, and it is also the subject of emergency measures. In Europe, it's already present in Italy, in Spain, in Portugal, and in France. But we decided to bring to you this example because it reports news about 10 plant species found positive to Xylella in the demarcated area in North Portugal. Among them, three were not listed as specified plants in the Commission implementing decision. So this example should make you think about the criteria of new host. Another example is the Fusarium oxysporum cubense, Tropical Race 4, which is now renamed Fusarium odoratissimum. This pest is a soil-dwelling strain of the fungus Fusarium oxysporum cubense that causes Fusarium wilt in bananas. This pest is not listed in the European legislation and not in the EPO list, so the European Plant Protection Organization list, the European Mediterranean Plant Protection list. It is originated in Asia. However, now it's spread in South America, in Mozambique, in Africa, and in Australia, which are the most important producing banana countries. This pest is very dangerous because it cannot be eradicated from the soil with the use of fumigants and not even with fungicide. But we decided to take this example because this newsletter included one article about the first finding of the pest in Mayotte, French territory, in one plot on banana. So this example should make you think about the criteria of new finding of not regulated pest.
These two scientific articles about Xylella fastidiosa have been reported in the 17th issue of the scientific newsletter, which was published in May 2020. They have both been published in the journal Plant Disease, and their topic is new houseplants. This bacterium, as Katerina said, is under official control, and it has been causing already a lot of damages, mainly on olive and almond trees in several European member states, Italy, Spain, France, and Portugal. So the first article we chose to select, it reports the first finding of Xylella fastidiosa on an ornamental tree, Gleditia trichiantos. And the second article, it also relates a new houseplant, the blueberry, but this time, for the subspecies Fastidiosa of Xylella fastidiosa. These two findings allow us to add two new host plants on the list of known host plants for Xylella fastidiosa and Xylella fastidiosa subspecies Fastidiosa.
Okay, now one extra example from the media newsletter, just to stress well the concept. In here you can see one of our Spodoptera frugiperda. This example is about Spodoptera frugiperda, which is taken from one our latest newsletter edition, the number 38. Spodoptera frugiperda, also known as the fall armyworm, has been a raising concern in the last year. It's a very polyphagous, voracious and resilient pest. It is regulated and it is subject of European emergency measures. In the last month, it has been detected in Australia and we were able to report this news through our newsletter. But we decided to bring to you this example mainly because in these articles, we were able to report a new biological control, Cotesia isipe hymenoptera, a parasitoid of the pest, discovered by the International Center of Insect Physiology and Ecology in Kenya. So, in this case, this example should make you think about the criterion of biological control for already regulated pests. But in general about control measure for regulated pest.
To retrieve articles or sets of keywords to our ontologies are scanned on more than 10,000 sources. These sources originate from 196 countries and they are written in 72 languages. As you can see on the pie chart, the most common language is English, but the majority of sources are not in English. To be able to retrieve information from these sources, we want to further improve the set of keywords we use with new keywords written in these languages. At the moment, we monitor 1,148 pests with specific and well-known keywords. And as I said earlier, we also intend to monitor new pests. For doing so, we have created a set of generic keywords relevant to plant pests as a whole, but not specific to any given known pest. For example, emerging invasion spread, also crop names and terms related to damages of plant pests, such as damaging, chlorotic, infection, etc.
So, in this slide, you can easily see the structure of the Plant Health Media Newsletter. Reading one of our newsletters, the first thing that you will encounter is the table of content with cross-references. By the way, we already finalized 39 media edition, and of which 38 have been already published. So just to say, it's quite a number. The second thing that you will encounter reading our newsletter is the introduction. In the introduction, you will encounter the scope of our exercise. We define the scope of our exercise. We define the categories of pests monitored. And we also provide a table of icons. The icons are something that we use to facilitate the reader to understand better the main feature of the pest of which we talk about. For example, we have icons regarding the presence or the absence of the pest in Europe. We have icons indicating if the pest is polyphagous or not. We have icons indicating the symptoms that this pest can cause. After that, you will encounter the main issue. Maybe you heard already us saying main issue, but basically the main issue are just summarizing the most relevant news that we selected for certain pests. After the main issue, you will encounter the selected articles. The selected articles are not only all the articles that we used to build our main issue, but are also all the articles that we thought to be relevant according to our criteria. Each article comes with its link to the original source, with a translation in English when it's needed, and with the date of publication. So basically the reader will always be able to go back to the original source where we retrieve the information and verify it on its own. Here we provided some example of our main issues, as I was say, as I was saying. First of all, from the newsletter number 36, we have Spodoptera frugiperda that I mentioned already. As I was saying, this pest is spreading in Australia. We were able in the newsletter number 36 to report articles about its first detection in Australia. To be precise, it was firstly detected in the Torres Strait and then it was detected on the mainland. Then we have a main issue regarding Xylosandrus compactus. This main issue is taken from the newsletter number 35. Xylosandrus compactus is a pest which is included in the EPO alert list since 2017. This pest, probably originating from Asia, is highly polyphagous and voracious. In the last few years, it has already been reported from Italy and France damaging Mediterranean woody plants. But in this edition, we reported articles about its first detection in Mallorca, Balearic Island, so Spanish territory, for the first time on the carob tree, so Ceratonia siliqua. And again, we go back to Xylella, the queen of the bacteria. In this main issue from newsletter number 34, we talk about the further spread of the bacterium in Apulia, so Italy, but we also report the first detection in Corsica, French territory, of an infected pink laurel, Nerium oleander. Last but not least, we have a very interesting main issue regarding Lytilenchus crenate. Lytilenchus crenate is a nematode very recently added to the EPO alert list. But this pest is very exemplificative of our work because we were monitoring the disease associated with this pest since 2018. When the scientific name of the pest was not yet associated to the disease. So following the development of the beech leaf disease, we were able to monitor its spread in Ohio, New York, Pennsylvania, Ontario, on American beech, the Fagus grandifolia, as well as the non-native beech trees. Following so the development of the fact, at the end, in the newsletter number 33, we were able to report news about the isolation of the nematode, its description, and its association to the beech leaf disease.
For the scientific newsletter, the article referred to the same pest as for the media newsletter. The table of content present the pests listed per production sector, such as forest, fruit plant, vegetable, ornamental, etc. After an introduction page, the selected articles are present. For each pest discussed, its name, taxonomy, and listing are displayed. Also, if we have enough information about the pest, an icons table is built. It contains some data, such as the main crops affected, the feeding habits, the type of impact, and the presence or absence in European Union. Finally, the article title is displayed with an hyperlink leading to the journal website and the full text if available. We also display the journal name, the article date of publication, and the first sentences of the abstract. Here are several examples of articles we chose to publish in the 17th scientific newsletter we published in May 2020. They all relate to pests of concern for European Union. Either they are already known and listed or newly discovered pests. The first article I chose to show you is about the citrus wallowing disease, a quarantine pest. It is a very destructive citrus disease and is so far absent from European Union. The article is about the prediction of its potential distribution in the context of the Mediterranean basin and can bring information to the risk managers, which work is to avoid the arrival of the disease in European Union. The other article is about a forest insect called Anoplophora glabripennis. It is already present in several countries of European Union and is a quarantine pest. The article topic is a new detection method. The report of detection method for quarantine pests is relevant because a mandatory check of quarantine pests on commodities such as non-square root needs to be done to prevent the spread of the pest. These three other articles are respectively about a new pest and two first findings. The first article reports the discovery of a viroid called plum viroid 1. As it was unknown so far, we did not have any specific keyword about this pest. Following this article selection, a specific set of keywords related to this pest is created and added to our set of keywords. We now monitor the publication of articles related to this pest. The two remaining articles are both about the tomato brown fruit rugose virus, a virus recently arrived in the European Union and now regulated under EU emergency measures. These two articles report respectively the first finding on sweet pepper in Italy and the first finding of the virus in Egypt. These two information are of interest for the European Union risk managers.
So in this slide you can see our virtual issue on Wiley EFSA Journal. A virtual issue is just a dedicated page on Wiley where you can find all of our media newsletters since 2017. But very soon also the scientific newsletter will be published and we will have a section dedicated to the scientific newsletter too. Let me just remind you a couple of things. First of all, when you will finally have the chance to see this slide after the presentation, bear in mind that in the title there is an hyperlink, so clicking on virtual issue you can directly go on our virtual issue. On the other side, at this point of the presentation, I would also like to remind you to continue to add your question to the Q&A panel, since we will dedicate a few more minutes after the presentation in order to address them all. In any case, you can also contact us at your own time by email, and we will take the time to address every question by email, just in case we didn't finish all of them during the presentation.
On this slide, you can see our perspectives for the project. In collaboration with the GRC, we will further adapt the platform to the monitoring of scientific literature, also adding new scientific sources. We also plan to improve the ontology for unknown pests, adding keywords in different languages. The enrichment of the ontology regarding the different languages will also cover the common name of the pest.
Several publications are also planned. As I was saying, all the edition of the scientific newsletter will be soon available on Wiley on the virtual issues, as well as the reports on our monitoring activity and on the pest scoring.
You can follow us on Twitter, where we will notify all the publications as soon as they are available on Wiley.
Okay, so now we are going to reply orally to some questions received to the Q&A box. But feel free to continue to write your question, as in 5 minutes you will no longer be able to do so. In any case, you can also contact us by email after the end of the webinar, and you will receive all the information that you requested concerning the Horizon Scanning presentation, of course. So now we should choose a couple of questions that we can answer orally, and I see there are many. But okay, let me try with this one from Christian. Christian asks, do you have any example where the media monitoring was applied by EFSA or member states and worked? So, dear Christian, this is a good question, and I will try to explain it a bit. I think that the best thing is to give you a practical example. In this presentation, I already spoke about Spodoptera frigiperda, so I will speak about this pest again because it's actually a good case to answer your question. The spread of Podoptera frigiperda in Africa has been a very discussed topic in the media, and it was reported in basically many of our newsletters since 2017. It happened then that following the presentation of our newsletter more or less May 2017, at the meeting of Plant, Animal, Food and Feed, so the PAF meeting at the Plant Health section, the European Commission requested EFSA to urgently carry out a categorization of the pest that initially was only planned in 2020. So then happened that a full risk assessment was carried out by EFSA, and on the basis of that, the European Union decided to take emergency measure against the pest. So I hope I answered to your doubts, and that was a tough question, but a good one to let's say show you a bit of our work.
I can see that there are other questions. I can pick one and answer one. So I can see a question from Tilly. Thank you for your question. Our question is, what developments of the project do you foresee in the future? So as I say in a previous slide, EFSA will continue this activity in the future. In few weeks, we hope to be able to publish the scientific newsletter on the Wiley, on the EFSA journal. One of the most concrete action we will lead is to add as many scientific sources as we can in the system to be able to have a full scope, not a full scope, but a bigger scope of information than we have now. And we are also finalizing the methodology allowing the identification of actionable pests, meaning the pests which are not yet regulated but are still for interest for the European Union territory. And all of that for them to be able to submit to the risk manager for them to support their decisions.
Okay, I see many questions, but sadly the time is running out, so we should move on our presentation, but all of your questions will be addressed, so do not worry. By email or here in the chat, all of them will be addressed. Oops. Okay. Yeah, of course, the acknowledgement.
So we wish to thank all the persons whose names are on this slide. Either they are from EFSA, ANSES, GRC, and of course, our expert from the working group for the validation of the newsletter.
And we sincerely want to thank all the colleagues of the Alpha Unit that supported this webinar emotionally, mentally and physically, Alice, Andrea, Maria Rosaria Mannino, which is our coordinator and supervisor, and without her this presentation would not have been possible, Giulia, Betty, Maria Chiara, Orestia and Sara. And finally, we would like to thank all the colleagues behind the doors for the technical support. Okay, here it is to bring to your attention that this is only the first one of a series of webinars in the context of the International Years of Plant Health. I hope you already know what is the International Year of Plant Health, but in any case, I suggest you to visit the new Plant Health website at the link we provide in this slide. You can also tweet about us, but most important about the International Plant Health with the hashtag that we give you here. But another trick can be follow us on Twitter at the Plant Health account to be always updated with all the news concerning our work, but mainly the International Year of Plant Health.
So please take 5 more minutes to fill out the evaluation form that you will receive shortly in your inbox. Your feedback will help us to improve our service.
So thank you for your attention.
And thank you for attending our webinar.
Okay, let me just remind you that this webinar has been recorded and hence it will be published into the webinar main page some days after the presentation. There you will always find useful link and referments. And thank you again, and that's all.